have submarine establishments spread on both the coasts of our country. Visakhapatnam being a premier institution, both for training and, of course, basing of the submarines. As was mentioned in the talk itself, the training establishment, premier training establishment, INS Satwana, with the escape training facilities as well, is located at located in INS Satwana, Visakhapatnam. And of course, the shooting was primarily done there of all the training aids that you saw in the film. And of course, some of the sea sorties that was conducted were done there. In addition, the team also visited Mumbai. We have another mother base, INS Vajrabahu, there. And of course, the Mazagon Docks Limited, which is our premier indigenous submarine construction yard, which operates under the Ministry of Defense. So, specific answer to your specific question, the entire shooting was spread virtually on both the coasts. Yeah.
Good afternoon, sir. I'm Kunal from PTI. My question is essentially about, since we are diving below the ocean, the cameras, and maybe Ms. Zulfia can help in. What were the challenges involved in submarine shooting, if I may use the word, sir, in terms of going down under? And because a lot of it I saw in the teaser was shot underwater. So if you could just explain the challenges and how you were able to tower it over. Thank you.
I'll just hand over to some, but then I'll just give an introductory remark. Yes, the team would have met with a lot of challenges and opportunity as well. But what the Navy did, as Captain Sharma also brought out, that we provided all logistics that was essential to shoot the exterior of the submarine, both whilst in harbour, secured alongside, and as she left harbour for her sea sortie, the other vessels which were utilized for shooting from external. As you see, as the submarine sailed out, obviously you need a vessel from, to be provided for shooting this. So I think, in short, the best that was possible to be provided to the crew of the Discovery Channel team, we provided. But if indeed some of these challenges that Ms. Zulfia wants to hide from us, she can, portray it just now.
Don't wish to hide anything. I think, like any filming crew, we're dictated by a certain timeline. They're dictated by a certain timeline. I think marrying of the two timelines and making sure the fact that we manage to get, once a boat moves, there are no second shot. You can't say, come back, let me take another shot. So you need to be very, very prepared, very, very thorough in your pre-production stage, where the camera is going to be, because there is just one way of getting that shot. After that, nobody is asking, nobody can ask, saying the fact that, why don't we come back and take the shot again? So I think they did their best, and we did our best to make sure the fact that the timelines matched, and we were as prepared as we possibly could be for the shoot. I think that was the only way. Logistic issues is a part and parcel of every film crew. This was no different in that sense. But I think in fact we were that well prepared that we managed to get a lot of things which we were not thinking that we would manage. So, but it was very, very interesting.
Were they allowed to shoot interiors of the submarine and which class? And were also they allowed to shoot around Arihant?
Simply put, the first part of your question, yes. The entire submarine was open to the crew. Insofar as the submarine that was put to sea along with the crew, there were no holds barred. And as you saw yourself, Harman, I think he was interacting with the crew more than I as a captain did in a short time. But having said that, in and around Arihant, definitely no. For a simple reason. One, of course, it's a strategic asset. There are prying eyes of unfavorable agencies. external. More importantly, the Prime Minister's office directives are very, very clear as to whom to permit, what to permit, and so on and so forth. And I'd like to suggest that even when some of the most high-ranking officials of the Government of India actually visit Vishakhapatnam, there is a multi-layered security clearances obtained, and of course, on-ground security. So this particular thing is an essay to portray the concept of submarine at large. I mean, if you see the concept at the end of the day, four serials, you'll realize for yourself, what are we trying to tell the public who view this, that here is a platform of which not much is known. Of course, you read, you fantasize. There are many movies like The Hunt for Red October, if you see, it's a classic movie. But even there, you will not get it's an in-depth of idea that the Discovery Channel has now done. So that is my brief answer to both your queries.
Okay, Srikant. Last row.
Admiral Srikant Datta from the New Indian Express. Could you, Admiral, draw a contrast and comparison between the submarine fleet of the Indian Navy and those of the Pakistan and Chinese navies?
Generically speaking, all the three nations are seafaring nations. All the three nations have decided that they must have a submarine fleet in their arsenal to meet their maritime interests. Each nation and its navy have their own concepts, their security interests, and their perspective plans. In terms of our own perspective plan, I think the Government of India, depending on what we need, what we can afford, and where we need to go in the century, have decided that we must have X number of submarines, both conventional and nuclear, and that's the way we are headed. As we speak today, Pakistan is a purely conventional submarine-oriented navy. Why is it so? I think technologically or industrially speaking, can they afford it is a moot point. Perhaps you would know more than I. Coming to China, it's a large nation. It has its own adversarial concerns. Is it competing against bigger nations? Both yes and no. But she's decided that I'm going to have both conventional and nuclear submarines as well, just like India is. So I'll not go into comparing the numbers that each nation has, whether conventional or nuclear. But I'd only suggest that any nation, depending on its security threat perceptions, economic affordability, and where she wants to get to in terms of securing her interests, I would decide on the numbers. So I don't think I can specifically answer comparing the numbers of the submarines that you have asked. But I think as a concept, I think all the three nations have decided what they must have. And they're maintaining their respective fleets, and Indian Navy is no different. As we look ahead today, we are a nuclear submarine operating navy. I think technologically we are geared up. We are building our infrastructure, concepts, maintenance, philosophy and policies. I think we are doing well for ourselves. So I'd like to leave it there.
Admiral Dinakar Peri with the Hindu. So you talked of additional submarine fleet. So can you just give a broader update on additional Scorpenes for the Navy? You know, where exactly is the status of it? And also, if you can just talk about the Scientify India, where are we right now? Scientify India.
It's a very current and valid question. A lot of media reports have been published on our maritime perspective plan. I think the maritime perspective plan, maritime capability perspective plan, which covers both surface navy units, aircraft, and of course the submarines, have definitely a specific number of submarines. But within this plan, which was sanctioned by the Government of India in 1999, we have gone ahead with future acquisition of conventional submarines. As you're aware, that the 13 conventional submarines that we now operate, both of the Shishmar and the Sindhu Ghosh class, They are aging. But aging is not a problem by itself. There are plans to modernize, upgrade, fit them with state-of-the-art and future-looking weapons and the weapon systems. Now, coming specifically to Scorpene itself, the Government of India sanction exists for 6 Scorpenes, of which we commissioned the first of them in the reborn Kalvari on the 14th of December last year by our Honorable Prime Minister. 5 of them will follow at quick intervals. The second and the third are already undergoing sea trials. Insofar as additional Scorpenes are concerned, of course, there are speculations. Of course, there are demands to continue with this series production just because we have a production line in Mazagon docks. But I think I would suggest that I think the job on hand of completing the already sanctioned 6 Scorpene submarines of the Kalvari class must be completed first. Each one, ideally, it should have been commissioned many years back, but there have been certain delays due to unavoidable reasons. Now, coming to 75 India itself, much has been written in the media, as I read it myself, about the strategic partnership. The Government of India, I think very responsibly, is taking steps correctly. I would not like to call it making haste slowly, but I think enough is being done to get this strategic partnership model correct. There will be a private player, there will be a public sector undertaking player, and that's how the strategic partnership goes. As to how many, what is the number of submarines that are going to come up in 75 India, it will well be within the capability perspective plan of 24 submarines that has been sanctioned by the Government of India. At this point of time, what are the timelines that we have set for ourselves of 75 India? It is not very easy to say, but I would like to assure you that plans afoot are being executed. Once this strategic partnership model gets into place, I think we are on song, and the minimum number of submarines that are required, even out of these 24, will definitely be maintained to ensure our maritime interests.
Anybody else?
Okay,
Suchi.
The last of the two, Scorpene submarines were to be equipped with the DRDO AIP, which are not yet ready. So what are your options now?
If I understood you correctly, you're talking about the 5th and the 6th Scorpene? One, we have something called the medium refit, medium life upgrade. That is a concept which happens even for ships. What happens is that if you take the life of a ship or a submarine as 25 to 30 years, traditionally, by the time he or you know, the surface ship or the submarine reaches midpoint in her career of 25 to 30 years, some of the systems, sensors, weapon themselves, they become a little obsolete. So that gets up. So the air-dependent propulsion system is another classic example of a capability that we do not have it today. We have catered for it in a, you know, fitted for kind of a concept. That means as and when we are ready with this model, we're going to fit it. The DRDO sponsored, DRDO developed air independent propulsion system is in a fairly advanced stage of I would say experimental trials, if I may say so. The next step, once it is proven ashore, it will have to be marine tested, in the sense that it has got to be proven for a marine platform. I'm not saying that we are very near from completing it, but I think by the time the 5th and 6th submarine get commissioned and they are due for their, I would say, maritime experimental trials, the dual dream of the DRDO developing an indigenous air independent propulsion system on the one hand, and to operate a submarine which is going to have an enhanced, I would say, endurance at sea without actually having come to periscope depth to charge our batteries. It is going to give us this capability. Just to compare, Pakistan in the Augusta 90 Bravo program got this MESMA air independent propulsion system from the French. It has got an approximate 14 to 16 day additional endurance at sea, just purely because of this AIP. We need to get there, we will get there, and from conventional submarine point of view, it is as good as a nuclear propulsion without touching the surface of air.
Sir,